So, hello and welcome to yet another School Synergy workshop series session. And we are fortunate enough to have with us here Dr. Sindhu Mathai. And she will be talking to us about graphical literacy. But just first, I just want to share with you all what School Synergy workshop series is all about. So we have been doing these workshop series physically in the year 2018, and in 2019, July onwards, we have been having this session every Saturday, 3 to 4 p.m. The main objective of these sessions is to create a platform where the ideas from university as well as school spaces can be shared, and a conversation space can be established between the teacher educators and teachers. The teachers can also share their experiences. They can get ideas which implement directly in practice. So people who have been attending for several months know that we design these sessions in a very interactive way. We engage a lot of teachers in sharing their ideas, their thoughts. And we would also love to know if you have ever implemented any of these ideas in your practice. It would be really nice to share. So to extend this conversation beyond this online session, we have also established a Telegram group. And I'm very happy to tell you that already around 176 people have become member of this Telegram group. It is called School Synergy Teachers Forum. And we plan to extend the conversation beyond this online session on the Telegram group itself. Like, we can discuss questions, we can share resources that we know about, we can share experiences that we have tried using these ideas in the classroom itself. So feel free to join this Telegram group. I'll be sharing the link in the chat itself during the session itself. Okay. So now I just want to share something about Dr. Sindhu Mathai. She has been my colleague at Humi Baba Center for Science Education, where we were doing PhD together. And I have known her for several years. And she has worked in the area of biology. And it is really nice to also see today that she's going to talk about graphical literacy based on the study that she has done with students. Her PhD work, I was like sort of engaged. We have been very impressed by that when we were in Humi Baba Center. It was understanding the structure and function of the different organs of the systems itself, of plants, parts and things like that. So it was very interesting. And I hope that even today's session would be very interesting for all of us. Right now, she is engaged in Azim Premji, and she has been working there for several years with teachers and with students also. So over to you, Sindhu. Would you like to share something?
Yes. Yeah. Thanks, Ruchi, for that kind introduction. Yeah. And thank you for inviting me today. It's a pleasure to be here, and I hope the session goes off well. So as you may have understood from the name of the topic of the session, I'm going to be speaking about some key findings from a small study that I did along with colleagues at IIIT Bangalore on children's understanding and interpretation of graphs, simple graphs. And the interest came from multiple dimensions. Of course, as Ruchi has already pointed out, I have an interest in understanding diagrams, children's visual spatial reasoning, particularly in biology, but broadly as well. And some researchers from IIIT, whom I will refer to in the talk, were interested in also seeing how one can develop graphs so that it is understandable and usable by visually challenged learners, right? So we've not yet got there, but still we hope that some insights from here will be useful there. So to begin with, I'm just going to share a few graphs, right? Three to be precise. These are, I will refer to the context of this graph a bit later, right? Can you all see this graph? It's a little small. I wanted everything on one screen, so I reduced the zoom, but is it readable with a little effort?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes?
Ma'am.
Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
So I want you all, I was just wondering, should I divide you into breakout rooms, etc., but probably not. Instead, I will ask you all to individually just go through this particular question, which was given to grade five children from a larger questionnaire. Try to read the graph, see what you can comprehend, try to answer the questions that follow, and also make a note of the steps that you underwent while you were trying to comprehend and answer these questions, right? I hope it is clear what you need to do. Not to test you on anything. This is only to understand the processes that one goes through cognitively while reading a graph, right? So try and see what are you looking at first in the graph, right? What are particular elements of that graph that you're focusing on more, perhaps? What may be difficulties that you experience, and any other comments, right? And I'll show you two more. Maybe you can just make notes for the moment and we'll discuss it later. Answers, it's fine. You can, you need not share, you could share up to you, but the idea is,
when you want them to share on the chat itself or just write it for themselves and
you can write
she'll
it
ask
for yourself.
You to share later on, perhaps
on. So, I'm assuming answers you would be able to get, that's fine. We are also interested in the processes. So, so I'd like you to make a note of that. Yeah. So can we move on to the next graph? Ruchi, the waiting room people, somebody will take care of, right?
That's
fine. You're admitting them. All right, because that. I was randomly doing a bit of that as
no,
well.
No, you don't need to do that. We'll
Sure.
Myself, Chitra, and Deepa, we all are.
Sure. Okay, so I'll move to the next graph. Similarly.
Sindhu, is it possible to just slightly increase?
Zoom in. Okay. I think then I'll have to stop sharing probably and do that because this is on. Oops.
What about others? Are you able to see it clearly?
Well, actually, I'm on the cell phone, so I'm able to zoom in by
you
splashing
can zoom
it up.
In
you're
on.
Able to zoom in. Yeah, because
if you're on a laptop, I guess it would still, I guess in that you could kind of just increase a screen or something of the kind. I don't know.
Yeah, if you can do that, because I want everything on the
then just share screen. Again. Yeah. I'll try that.
Sorry, this is the first one. Yeah, the second one, right? Yeah. Okay, can I move to the next one? It's fine if you've not attended to it in all its entirety, right? The idea is only to get a sense of how you've perceived it. Okay, so I'll move to the next one.
Okay, done.
Okay, yeah, fine. So it's okay if you've not been able to look at all the questions completely. The idea is only to get a sense, as I said, right? So can anyone share, I mean, more than the answers we can, of course, discuss and I can share with you, but how did you go about it? What were the difficulties you experienced? And in any other comments, right? And I mentioned the grades in front of each question, right? You have grade 5, grade 7, and grade 9. And I marked a question number because it's taken from a larger questionnaire, as I said. Yeah, anyone? The first question, which I've focused on right now, grade 5 question 4. Yeah.
Can we speak, or you would like us to write it in the chat room?
No. It's good if you can speak so that you can describe it better. No, yeah. Process. Yeah.
I think this was a very simple graph. I did enjoy going back and forth. I think more than the questions, I spent time absorbing and observing the graph to see the various variations which are there and things like that. And then the questions kind of got pretty easy. So questions also were relatively easy when I compare it to the other two. But the first one was not so tough.
Mm-hmm.
What would be a challenge is if I was not very good with the numbers and the visuals, because there is the black and the gray, and this one is up and down, and this one is touching the line. It isn't, you know, mm-hmm. I'm an early years teacher, so I know that something mm-hmm. as simple as even that affects my children.
Okay.
Lines okay. and the bars and multiple bars all on one sheet can sometimes mm-hmm. fox somebody who's not very visual with mm-hmm. it.
Okay. Thanks, Gayatri, right? Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah, Gayatri. Anyone else would like to answer?
Ma'am, Ajay here. Ma'am, for me, actually, I was thinking in terms of the normal human growth. So first it is two, yes. then eating, starting. So starting to walk, it's actually it should come in a single line. That's what I used to think. But now mm-hmm. here it is given in separate sections. So to recognizing that was the first challenge. After that, okay. it was easy.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so you're saying one, you have a certain expectation, right? That growth will proceed in a certain kind of proportional relationship, right?
Yes.
And you're sort of, that sort of gets disrupted when you see that it doesn't quite go according to that order. That is one. But after that, you said it got easy. In the sense, how did it become easy after that? Again, imagine, of course, for you, it probably was easy, but also imagine a grade 5 child attempting it. What would have been difficult for that child?
Yeah. So from grade 5 student perspective, one has to look at that. What kind of previous knowledge the child would be having, and based on that, In what way would the child be perceiving these lines there?
Yes. Yeah, so, it could be anyone else also. If you,
Huh. When I speak,
yes, Monica.
So basically, from a child's perspective, it would be that the numbers, the 4 and 6. Okay, so anyway, the six is higher than 4. It's greater than 4. So I would always rate the 6 higher. So I could go in for a person like Priya. I could see the gray color with Priya's name. So I could just blindly write Priya. For the next milestone, I could just blindly write Asha, because I can see Asha has the highest milestone in terms of eating mashed solids, and so on and so forth. So I could not actually relate and understand and comprehend properly, but I could just see the numbers and the bars with the colors and associate them and do it. That's it.
Yeah. Thank you. And I also see those chat messages from Kamal, Preet and Ajay. Yeah. So the fact that, you know, you look at higher as being, you know, having achieved, right? Something, right? Got the first higher mark or the first prize or whatever, right? Higher meaning better in some sense. And here you see that that actually if you've reached a milestone earlier, then you should be lower down in terms of age, right? And that can be something quite complex for a grade 5 child to understand, right? Who started, who got the first tooth earlier and who started walking earlier. You can very well think that, you know, that, oh, okay, who got there first, right? And sometimes that can be, oh, the higher score, but then you see it's counterintuitive here, right? Okay, this the next the next graph. Who would like to volunteer? So it's fine if you've not looked at all the questions also, but I'd like you to reflect on what could be challenges for a grade 7 child. Again, now we are talking of two grades, you know, a different stage, curricular stage as well, right? A middle schooler and an older child who has gone through, you know, some introduction to graphs and data handling a little more.
Anyone? Yeah, go ahead, Ajay.
So three different sets of data are given in one single graph. So it would have been easier if age is separated from height and all.
That can be confusing, you're saying. Excuse me. Yeah, so you're saying that because there are three different bars and they're just separated by, you know, this grayscale, that can be confusing for a child, all right?
Yes.
Okay. Anyone else who hasn't spoken would like to volunteer?
Please, we would really like you all to engage and share your ideas.
Yes,
Pallavi, go ahead.
I noticed that the questions here are more about relationships in the data versus directly asking for a point in the data. It's not a direct question. It's a relationship that the child has to figure out, which means look at all the numbers and understand how they relate, and then try to answer the question. So there is another level of complexity in that.
Yes. There's some computation that the child has to perform, and as the earlier speaker pointed out, that you know, there are these you know, three different data points, data labels, you know, huddled together under each name. So it's quite possible that, you know, the child has to juggle as well between multiple data points there. But yeah, there are relational comparisons, as you mentioned out. It's not something that you can easily read off, right? And yes, yeah. Anyone else would like to add on? Thank you for that.
I would like to tell that there's a concept of assertion and reasoning over here.
Yes.
You have certain assertions over there. And again, reasoning part, the child has to do whether that assertion is correct or not correct, then reason it out. Based on that, if they are not trained to do that, then they'll be finding it difficult to interpret this graph. That is my interpretation.
Yes. So you're saying that if you are, so when you use the word assertion, that's quite interesting, right? Reasoning, yes. But the child should be able to sort of hypothesize as well. Would you say that?
No, ma'am. Assertion always means certain facts which are pre-known to them.
Okay. So that's what you're referring to. Okay, because I was looking at assert also as a verb.
No, the schools we have certain questions, there are certain facts are given to them, then there are certain assertions as well as reasons. They come to a conclusion whether it is correct or not correct. So this graph also may lead to that. Unless and until the child is taught about this concept, they'll not be able to interpret, because a lot of increases, decreases, so many comparisons have to be made based on the facts that are given in the table in the pictorial manner. That's what I mean to say.
Okay. Got it. So I was wondering if by facts you meant, the graphical conventions.
Yes, right? It is graphical.
Also, graphical conventions as well. So that's very important, and it's an interesting point that you've made. Yeah. And if the child isn't explicitly taught that, right, it is quite, or doesn't have practice with that, if not in the classroom, in some informal setting as well, it's going to be quite difficult, right, reading this.
That's what I mean to say.
Anyone else would like to? Okay, let's move to the third one. Again, I'm not discussing every question. Let's see. Probably, informally we could also discuss. Yeah, I'm just looking at time as well. But broadly. This is now for a grade 9 child.
May I?
Yes, sure.
I found this actually fairly much more simpler compared to the previous graph, because it's again very clear data points, and the questions that are required to be answered are again very straightforward, because they refer to exact data points and not necessarily comparative or looking at two different points together to figure out an answer.
Probably the questions, as you're saying, but what about the lines itself to the bars?
They still seem to have a certain clarity in terms of, because it's very clear that the solid line is Rajasthan, the gray dotted line is Tamil Nadu, and the other one is Karnataka. So there's a lot of, seems like it still has some certain clarity to it.
How do you think that students will think about these lines, these three different lines? Would they be able to say that, what would an increase indicate? What would a decrease indicate? Would they be able to understand those points?
I'm imagining that by grade 9, they're able to maybe understand that as a dip and a high, and low points and high points, and it's an imagination again.
Thanks for that. As you're saying, perhaps there's a clarity in looking at those lines, and there's a sort of you don't have to juggle too much probably, compared to the earlier bar. Any other, I'm looking at the chat comments as well. Any other comments on this?
Can I?
Yeah, sure.
So if they're aware of the months, and if they know as we move from left to right, it's normally increasing, and if they can relate the dotted lines between the two points, I think then they can make sense as to this is.
So what you're saying is some conventions about graphs, right, and lines particularly, and the two dimensions, they can if they are sort of familiar with the conventions, then so it's not it's not meant to be true in that sense, right? It's made up, but the fact that if they are sort of familiar with the conventions, it should be fairly easy, right? But they need that familiarity and practice with conventions, and also this idea of increasing and decreasing and what it means, and so that's
Asha, would you like to share? Ashutreja, would you like to share how you scaffold the students' to understand the increase and decrease? I mean, how are you visualizing one can scaffold that?
I think because although the grade 9 students are a little mature enough, but still I would like to ask them through intervening questions how you are seeing the range of the temperature going high and down, so that they would express it or interact through verbal expressions. They would like to say how much in value, the numerical value, there is an increase and then there is a decrease. So that the students get an opportunity to speak about in the terms of the numerical values also, that how
yes.
the range of the temperature is changing across these 6 months, and then compare across the three states.
Yes, yes. Yeah, to be able to quantify it. Of course, they can connect the dip and the height, right? Perceptually with going down and coming up. But then to quantify it and, you know, look at the average and compare the states, right? It requires fair bit of teacher talk and scaffolding in the classroom to enable that, right? Or practice with that. Yeah, yeah. So that's interesting that you pointed out that scaffolding is necessary. Yeah. Anything else? Okay, so thank you all of you for that, for those interesting thoughts that you shared. I'm actually going to connect these to a small study that, just give me a minute. I seem to have to reorient myself. Yeah, a small study that we carried out, the context of which I broadly gave you in the beginning. Which is to understand how children in grades 5, 7, and 9 across three curricular stages perceive and interpret graphs, right? And what you have all pointed out are probably the, you know, two, three graphs which I picked from about 7 or 8, which contexts or stimuli which were given to children, which they found a little difficult, right? I wouldn't say very difficult, but a little difficult. So it's interesting to see what is it that children are interpreting from these graphs, and what can we understand as teachers about the kind of scaffolding and classroom engagement that needs to be provided, right? This is just an introduction to why graphical representations are important. They are used for representing information, form important elements of the school curriculum. And this development of understanding of graphs, also called graphical literacy or graphicacy, has transferable skills across the curriculum. Why? Because it is a kind of prelude to the development of abstract thinking, right? Which is important, not only in a subject like math or science, but across the curriculum. So this study aimed to understand how children across school stages comprehend and interpret some simple graphs, right? Simple bar and line graphs. So we did not look at very complex graphs, or we didn't go for pie graphs, but basically simple line and bar graphs, right? Very briefly, what are the processes involved graph comprehension? You see that, the construction of a graph essentially involves the conversion of experiences into particular representations, right? And what is very critical here is that you're not looking at one or two elements, right? As you, many of you pointed out, you're looking at a simultaneity, right? Of multiple elements, right? Various conventions that are associated with graphical representation, at the same time, variables that have been collected, right? So it's a kind of simultaneity of perception that allows you to comprehend, right? What is actually happening and what is being represented. And then usually we try to choose an appropriate graphical representation depending on what we want to denote, right? Whether it's a line, bar, pie, etc. A bar chart, as we all know, is usually the simplest graph that's presented to children, and it involves a numerical attribute associated with different values of a single variable, and therefore you find them more commonly and frequently used in the lower grades as well, and the primary level as well. And graphs representing relationships between variables, however, involve measurements of at least two variables most of the time, such as in the line, pi, etc. And therefore, it is also a little more complex for children to bring together, right, two different variables at the same time, do some computation with the data that's given to them. Okay, and I'm sorry, I seem to be skipping of just a minute. So what is comprehension? What does comprehension involve? Comprehension involves familiarity with the signs that a graph makes use of. And it involves moving beyond these individual signs to sign complexes. And often there are some mental models that you form which integrate visual and textual information, which helps students in reasoning and problem solving. I'm going a little quicker so that we can get to the data. But if any of you have anything to discuss or you'd like to have any readings on these, please let me know towards the end of the session. Yeah. There are also levels of statistical literacy, particularly with reference to graphs that have been identified. This is actually a Japanese paper, and you have all these different levels starting from A1 to F that have been identified, which look at different stages, right, in the development of understanding of graphs, right? So level A, which is composed of sub-levels A1, A2, A3, and A4, involve a basic reading of tables and graphs, which also includes reading key features and comparing information from two graphs or reading, you know, a very simple trend in graphs. And then you have level B, which involves understanding what constitutes an appropriate source of data for a given question. Right? So the kind of processes that all of you were employing when you were trying to answer a question, right? What constitutes, what is the kind of data that I need to look for, compare, and understand better? Understand to be able to answer the given question. Then you have more complex levels, which involve statistical computation, level C, level D, understanding global trends, which involves some bit of extrapolation as well. And level E, which involves understanding what is the qualitative information embedded in the quantitative information. So, for instance, what do the data on the temperatures, you know, tell us about a particular place, for instance, or what may be a significant point in the data to understand better based on the trend that you see, right? So being able to extract that and being able to understand what needs to be looked at more deeply. And level F, which involves creating new dimensional information, which is a fairly advanced, very advanced level of adding another dimension, or being able to imagine that, right? So these are actually, in this study too, we try to look at that, though I won't be presenting it here, but we notice that we see that most students are able to find across grades 5, 7, and 9, they're able to answer questions pertaining to level A much more easily. They're able to fare better in those levels compared to B, C, D, E, and F. We had one or two questions in level F, but that was also quite difficult for them to understand and respond to. So very briefly, these were some questions that we looked at in the study. How do students interpret and comprehend simple bar and line graphs? What are common perceptual strategies used during comprehension? What are some developmental differences that we see in comprehension? How does school curriculum and pedagogy influence this comprehension? And how does prior content or domain knowledge influence the interpretation of graphs? Also, what are some implications for pedagogy and the development of material, right? A few implications I will draw. Development of material we are still working on. And we'll get to in a bit. I think I'll just skip this slide for the moment. Yeah. Methodology. So four schools were selected for this study, and all in Bangalore. All were inclusive schools, with most of them admitting students from varying socioeconomic backgrounds and employing a variety of pedagogical approaches for teaching and learning. Grades 5, 7, and 9, as I mentioned already, were selected, and students from a particular grade from each of these sections, and subject to their willingness to be part of the study, were selected. And we also observed school and classroom environments in these four schools, interviewed the head teachers and teachers in these schools to understand what kind of curriculum and textbooks were being adopted, as well as pedagogic practices. And we administered a survey, right, a questionnaire, parts of which you just saw when you were trying it out yourself, with supporting texts and also questions. And then we interviewed a few students and teachers based on their responses. Not all students were interviewed, but a few based on some interesting sort of responses that they gave. Briefly, a description of the four schools, because we will come back to this at the end. School A, most children from upper and middle class backgrounds, multiple curricular and co-curricular activities being conducted here, in addition to the regular classes. So you do have children plotting graphs as part of their projects, data collection as part of informal activities that they do. So this is beyond the requirements of the curriculum or the math textbook, which has a chapter on data handling. This is beyond that when they do various projects and they collect data and they plot graphs. So a fairly enriched environment there, both pedagogically as well as the kind of experiences, informal experiences outside the classroom that children have. School B, most children from lower socioeconomic background, but very engaged and motivated teachers, handling constraints of large classes, but working very hard with the children beyond formal classroom. And the school follows the state and PU board that's in Karnataka. School C, from children from mixed socioeconomic backgrounds, though primarily from middle income groups. Pedagogy is quite conventional with emphasis on rote learning and a lot of complaints about children's capabilities that you keep hearing around, but still a fairly, an old school and therefore quite popular in the community. Being an old school and following certain traditional methods and therefore they also use various curricular material at the primary levels, not sticking to one particular board. School D is an alternative school with very small classes and the school uses multiple curricular materials, but it's difficult to see trends because of the very small classes, which become smaller as children move up towards the higher grades. So the questionnaires, these were developed based on the curricular stage, and we also drew from the NCRT, EVS, and primary math textbooks to understand what children would be comfortable with at that particular stage. And we also looked at some other good curricula, such as the small science and the Bal Vaigyanik textbooks. And then we analyze the responses. We try to, look at descriptively. We try to see what are patterns in students' responses. And we also try to see developmentally, how do the children's responses compare with the various stages that we saw. And we also did some inferential statistics to check students' performance across grades as well as across schools. And the questionnaire, one thing I forgot to mention here is that the questionnaire also had some questions for children, asking them to think about what are the processes they followed when they were trying to comprehend the graph and answer the questions. It was quite difficult for children to actually write that down, even though we gave them, some choices, but it was difficult for them to pinpoint. But when we asked them questions in an interview, they were able to answer better. So I'll come to that in a bit. By and large, we noticed that across grades, more or less normally distributed, a bit skewed to the higher scores. This is overall scores. And there are various categories we try to sort of divide students into based on scores. And we find that broadly grade 7 still seems to follow a more or less normal distribution, and you have, you know, a kind of equal category of students across, equal number of students across the three categories that we divided them into. But then you notice that grade 5 and 9 seem to tend towards the higher scores. This also perhaps has linkages with the curriculum at, you know, grade 4 and grade 8, which presents, you know, a kind of leap in terms of complexity and the number of different aspects related to graphs that are introduced, right? Okay, so some difficulties that children had, I think I already spoke about grade 5 question 4 that all of you tried in the beginning. And another question, vegetables I dislike, I think I have it here. Yeah, this is another question that students found difficult because it there is some additional information given in the question. If you see the top part of it, text which indicates that it's a class of 50 students. And based on that, students have to sort of infer how many, you know, how many students may not like more than one vegetable, and things like that. So in addition to the graphical representation, you have some additional data in the text, which if they miss, they then will not be able to answer this question, and therefore they found it difficult. Grade 7, again, some of you pointed out multiple bars, and again, these the graphs were printed in grayscale. So probably, you know, not being able to distinguish them properly, though, of course, many students said that they were able to, and some of you also said that you were able to distinguish it, but you have to be quite careful, right, in not mixing it up, but it could have been confusing. And there's also some prior knowledge of science content. So for instance, if you look at this particular question, there is a menu that's presented for different days of the week for lunch for children. And there are some questions based on that, as well as a graph on the kind of items that are served, right? And here, they also have to make a sense based on some prior knowledge that they have. For instance, how many vegetable items are also rich sources of protein, right? So for that, they also have to make use of some understanding of prior content in addition to their graphical understanding of graphical conventions. Grade 9, again, students pointed out that for some of the bar graphs, again, you saw a line graph. Line graph familiarity with conventions is important. If they've not learned that, then that becomes a challenge. Otherwise, the grayscale color differentiation again, and choosing the right answer when there is more than one right answer, but it is not represented in the answer choices, right? So you notice that there is more than one correct answer that you can come up with, but then you're in your answer choice, it is not represented, and therefore you have to be careful, right? This is an example of another grade 9 question, which involved what you had tried out was a line graph, but there were more complex questions which involved computation with large numbers as well as multiple bars. Okay. Some perceptual strategies used by children. So they responded in the questionnaire itself saying that they tended to look at the taller bar, the darker bar, the labels in the x-axis first, trying to arrange the bars to see which one was taller first. So visually trying to see, you know, to check which is the correct answer, because it was not ordered in the graph that was given to them. They were trying to do that mentally. And they were not calculating immediately. They were first doing this visual check and then moving on to the calculation. So their correct responses make use of a combination of perceptual strategies, knowledge of conventions, as well as prior content knowledge. So this is important. And of course, those who are paying attention to additional information given in the graph, such as a title, legend, data labels, units, so some bit of additional information given in the text. So those who are carefully attending to all of these details seem to be able to do better. Comparison, if we compare across grades, we notice that there is clearly an improvement in comprehension with higher curricular stage, And I already mentioned that grade 5 and 9 performance across schools sort of reinforces the leaps that curricula also make at grades 4 and 8. Across schools, we notice that schools using better pedagogic approaches, which is schools A and B that I mentioned earlier, have fared much better compared to those with more conventional approaches. And these differences are most tangible at the higher grades when you see cumulative advantages adding up, right? In various informal experiences, the curriculum also paying a lot of emphasis to graphs and things like that. Whereas grade 7, we didn't really see a significant difference across schools because also in terms of the curriculum, there didn't seem to be much happening, at least in these schools, and based on the curriculum they were following. The alternative school could not be compared very easily because of the smaller numbers, though they were, and they hadn't sort of done much by way of content as well. Strategies used by students. So besides the obvious perceptual strategy, there's also a compelling visual narrative. And what do I mean by that? That it's difficult to come up with a clear sequential trajectory of how they are actually comprehending graphs, right? Instead, they seem to be employing a sense of how things work, right? Which is that, for instance, there were some grade 5 high scorers who probably had just joined school or who were not a part of these informal activities that that the school was organizing for them. And they said that they had actually, never seen a line graph, but then they were able to infer based on their experience from a visit to the doctor's place or from seeing trends being reported in newspapers. So they were able to pick up from there and infer based on that. I think these points I've already mentioned. So these are some snippets from the conversations the interviews that we had with students. So high scorers in the 5th grade use certain strategies. As I've sort of highlighted some parts in red, right? I notice the big bar, then I look at the numbers, and then I look for the other bars, right? And I think arranging the bars in an order makes it easier to understand. And this student also said that changing the color or increasing the gaps between the bars won't make much difference, right? Because it's clear the understanding of conventions, understanding of prior content in some questions, it makes sense. And being able to, visually check, right? By ordering it in a certain manner or broadly checking for heights or, understanding and then doing a visual check. All of this, these strategies seem to help more than looking at explicitly changing the color, etc. And that seems to be a very important strategy that those students who have done well seem to be using. And then high scorers in the 9th grade said, I first read the question and then I saw the title and the legend and I just saw the people and the numbers and all because sometimes they are in persons or kgs and all, the units, right? So the student says, I'm careful to see, are they all in the same units? Are we expected to convert it into a different unit from what is given in the graph? And therefore I paid attention to that. And this student also says that the colors did not worry, did not affect comprehension as much. Then some more common difficulties in comprehension, that line graphs seem to be more difficult, but that's because of familiarity with conventions more than anything else. And data labels, lines and bars without vibrant colors can be difficult to compare mentally for students who are you do not have sufficient practice with these. Also that clustered bars are more difficult to process and things like that. And then you notice that those who are probably, this is the last couple of points that I'm making and then we can move on to a discussion. So children who had done well were using experience in a very different manner from those who were doing well, those who had done well and those who had not done so well were both using experience, but it was quite different, right? So there were children who were using prior knowledge from their doctor's visit to the doctor's place, right? Some familiarity with seeing graphs earlier, and trying to infer from that, but the others were not attending to the elements that that were given in the graphical representation, but inferring completely from an experience that they had, right? So that again becomes an issue. Okay, so probably I will stop here with the last slide. What are some implications for pedagogy? Engage teacher talk and classroom discussions to focus on developing mastery of graphical conventions, along with attending to the whole or the simultaneity of multiple such units in a single representation. So some of you mentioned that, that there needs to be this practice, these engaged conversations around how to read a graph and developing some mastery with the conventions that are used. Also development of facility with some symbolic manipulation of representations of, you know, basically symbols which refer to the real world, but are not the same. They're not likenesses, but they are entities that, that we are manipulating here. And also this, you know, this reasoning process, right, of how things work, what we call thinking out of the box, or, you know, this moving back and forth between what is critical here, a visual check, to the data labels if it's necessary, being able to draw relationships, do some simple computations, and then come up with a response, right? So, so there is, there seems to be some bit of transformational reasoning going on, right? Back and forth between multiple elements in the graph, which is important. And of course, adequate experiences for children in gathering data, producing and comprehending graphs beyond the school curriculum to enable meaningful comprehension, yeah? I'd like to acknowledge some of my collaborators in this project. Yeah, so we'll stop here and we can have a bit of a discussion, I think probably 10 minutes. Yeah, not much, but yeah. I just saw Ruchi's message saying there's a, yeah, I think what you've already mentioned, yeah.
No. Yeah, so any questions or comments that anyone wants to say? I have a few questions, but I'll just hold on.
I think I just ran through because, yeah, I was also hoping to make some time, but probably we can also continue conversations later. Yeah.
Questions, please? You can type on chat or even unmute. So I think meanwhile, I take the chance of asking you that.
Yeah, sure.
So see, what is it, what is the most important factor that is constraining the students in understanding graphs? Is it the conventions itself, or is it the visual representation, making a meaning of those visual representations itself?
What is it?
I mean, if you want
to say. It doesn't seem to be, I mean, definitely knowledge of conventions, because practice with that is the first step, to understanding. I mean, just the fact that you're able to comprehend what does this mean? What is the x-axis? What is a legend? Why is it important, right? What is a trend line? What is a bar graph? So these conventions are very critical. But if you look at students who have done very well, right? I mean, if you can look at a minimal kind of basic understanding, which involves conventions primarily, but an excellent understanding would involve being able to bring together, you know, content knowledge, being able to read based on the conventions, and bringing all of them together into a complex, right? That's what we see. So they're able to juggle back and forth. It doesn't seem to be straightforward. So we asked them to say, you know, what are the strategies you're using? They were not able to just say, I mean, I just saw this first, that first, and done, right? That I seem to be moving back and forth between, you know, and I don't realize that these bars are not, you know, not separated by, you know, a large number, and therefore I would check the data labels, right? So it definitely involves conventions, but the good students are making use of content knowledge, complexes between the various signs, and juggling between, also attending to details of the question very carefully, because they would miss out probably some elements of the question, and then, you know, or of the content that's given in the passage. And that also makes a big difference because they've not noted an important point. Yeah. So it seems to be, but knowledge of graphical conventions and discussing the pedagogy involving, you know, some discussion with how does one comprehend a graph of this kind, in consonance with a text which describes it, right? I think that kind of conversation we, in my understanding, we don't seem to be having sufficiently in the classroom, where we have a discussion on what strategies children use. Yeah. Yeah, I think not a very clear answer to, but yeah, it's a little big, yeah.
Yeah.
So my question to you is, ma'am, like as teachers, how can we make this graphical literacy better for our children?
Yeah, yeah. See, I would, yeah, so as I just pointed out, one is that there needs to be practice in informal settings, right? There is only so much that the classroom can do. So in the school where children seem to be doing well, they were involved with, you know, projects where they had to collect data, you know, draw up tables from there, you know, plot graphs. So they are able to see, you know, a deeper engagement, therefore, you know, with the graph rather than comprehending it as, you know, something that is there in their textbooks alone. So that's, these informal experiences seem to be very important, right? Or also experiences at home, I mean, not only in school, but the fact that you are, you know, reading from the media or, you know, you're sort of trying to understand, you know, what is it that, you know, what is this trend of, you know, COVID surge cases? What does it show? You know, some bit of interest there that also contributes. As we saw in a couple of cases, children said, we've never seen a graph like this before. We haven't actually studied it formally in school, but we're able to interpret because we're able to guess, right, from our prior experience a little bit, you know, that we've encountered before. So that seems to be very important. And conversations around how does one comprehend, how does one link the text with the conventions and the meaning, conversations around them in the classroom. These seem to be very important because otherwise children try to make sense of it themselves, but they don't seem to be, you know, getting very far unless they have the support available to them elsewhere.
Okay, so that means to say the main part lies on the teacher to give those kind of experience to the children in the classroom so that they can interpret those graphs in a better way when those kind of graphs come in their examinations or come they encounter in their real life or something like that. The yes, onus lies yes. on the teacher, right, to give those kind of exposure to the children to make them understand or interpret the graph in the best possible way.
Yeah, yeah, it's of course always a tall job for a teacher, right, to be able to do all of this. It will be good to have something outside the classroom as well, right, in terms of the co-curricular, in terms of project-based learning, because as we all know, there's only so much that the curriculum itself, you know, space that we can can have. But if you're able to make that space, that's the best. Yeah. But
I think the projects that you were mentioning, Sindhu, and if students are engaged in projects where they actually have to represent the data in a form of graph, and there is some change also happening in the data over a period of months, for example, like the height of a plant that they have planted, and everybody in a class is planted and they are all comparing each other's graph, they will be able to make much more meaning of that graph as compared to a graph that is there in the textbook itself.
True. So that seems to be what clinches it. All these experiences where they feel engaged in the context more than the graph itself. The graph is a natural corollary because the engagement is there.
I just wanted to add to that. I noticed actually in the examples that you showed us, the themes were menu for lunch, veggies that I don't like, etc., which are actually very relatable to the kids. And it probably becomes a much more interesting data to engage with. Versus saying pollution or which, you know, you, even a ninth grader might not feel very involved with pollution data or something.
Particularly when you keep hearing it all the time. But veggies you don't like, it's certainly something that's more interesting. True. So I think, context. And I think definitely at the primary level, the EVS books do a great job of presenting, right, very interesting contexts based on which and activities, right, that children can do. By the middle school, the content comes in. So we'll have to find interesting, right, contexts. But abstraction is important. That's a goal. We have to get there. And that's very important when you're reading graphs at a higher level. I think that's a good point. That it's important.
So Kaveri, would you like to share what was the project about? You say your students made
good evening,
this project using Excel and graph.
Myself, Kaveri Borthakur. I'm assistant teacher of science from Assam. My students have created, I have given them to compare their pollution data between two, for example, two cities, and they have collected the data from online, and they have put the data in MS Office with the help of bar diagram or pie charts. So they have done it by themselves, and that now, and by looking at the bar diagram, they could say that, okay, this city this month was much polluted than comparison to this city. So this is how I use graphs, ma'am.
Yes, yes. Yeah, I'm sure that that's an interesting project for students to take up, because it's not just a simple, you know, comparison. They're actually, you know, trying to make sense of it themselves. Yeah, I'm sure it would have been very interesting. And they would have learned all about graphs, bar graphs as well through that. Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah, yeah. Thank you, Kaveri. Yeah, any other questions? I think we've just about run out of time, but I think we can take a little more time, Ruchi, if there are questions.
Yeah, if there are Sindhu, any questions,
we can. This is Amit Singh from Heritage Gurgaon. My question is related to what was asked by Ruchi, just an extension of that thought. I mean, there wouldn't be any thumb rule to, you know, use a particular graph for a particular story narration. But generally, say in middle school program, like I'm teaching in middle school, what can be a good convention for any kind of data narration, you know, or any kind of visualization? What would you recommend, say, a fourth, fifth grader vis-a-vis a sixth, seventh, eighth grader?
Yeah, yeah. See, now it depends on the curriculum also being used in school. I noticed that, you know, if it's an IGCSE or which curriculum does Heritage for the CBSE? What are the textbooks?
Yeah, we have both. Yeah, we have both.
Yeah. So I noticed that with IB, IGCSE, I mean, students, they actually have data handling fairly early, and they also take this up. So it's difficult to generalize, but one would say that a multiplicity, right? Different kinds of representations, can be introduced, right, by the time the child is in sixth grade, compared to, you know, primarily bar graphs, the pictographs that are there in the NCRT books, as well as maybe some introduction to line graphs in the primary. Here they can, because they've done percentages, and, you know, they can definitely be introduced to pie charts, right, more complex histograms, and yeah, so in terms of kinds of graphs, I think a multiplicity. The other is, again, the same point, you know, whether they can be involved actively with some kind of data gathering. That would be more important than giving them. Of course, one can also engage with literacy skills by, you know, getting them to read a short text, and then based on that, you know, answer questions, maybe a little longer than what I have shown you through the questionnaire. I'm not sure if that answers the question you have asked. Probably if you'd specifically say for which, do you have thematic sort of learning, or do you have it as subjects? Because I assume this is a kind of more progressive kind of environment you're in. Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, in maths, of course, they are taught in data handling right from, say, grade four, and the learning, there's a progression in the learning.
Yes.
And their understanding also increases as time progresses. Say a seventh, eighth grader would have a better understanding of that.
Yes.
And maybe I'm assuming they can understand a scatter diagram as well.
Scatter plots. I think it can. Yes, it can be used well. Of course, you can use a line to connect some significant points as well, if that helps. For students who are just getting introduced. But I think, for seventh, eighth graders, scatter diagrams also work pretty well, because they've already understood conventions by then, and they do not really need, you know, something that's concrete by way of a bar or a connecting line. But students are struggling. You can, actually help them with that. Yeah. But in terms of context, yeah, definitely active gathering and plotting graphs, and reading perhaps a little more complex text and being able to understand that and interpret from there. I think that would be good for the older children, because literacy skills also develop then. Yeah.
So you recommend them
to, so I just wanted to share
them more, giving them more thematic based stories.
Definitely. Yes. I think that would be good. The one, they're ready for it in terms of development. The curriculum also makes, some leaps there. Mathematics content also has, a lot of progress made there in that front. So yeah, and also in terms of literacy skills, they've improved. So I think that would be very interesting to bring in some themes that can link multiple concepts along a piece of text and a graph that presents an interesting context. Yeah. Sorry, Ruchi, you were saying something?
I wanted to share, there is a very, very nice book called Dear Data.
Oh, I see. Okay.
Yeah. So okay. I think you should just Google it. It's about two girls who had switched the continent and they share their daily life through representation or different types of representation of data, like even something like they recorded how they were feeling after every hour, I think it was. I don't remember the details, but imagine, okay. If you're recording how you are feeling after every hour, and then you record that for perhaps a week, and then you switch it with another counterpart across the continent and how their days are going by, how they are feeling, whom they are meeting, and or even the kind of animals and birds and the kind of trees and plants that they are coming across each day on their walk from home to office or home to school at any point of time, and representing that through data. And it's not just data representation in form of the usual bar graph or line graphs itself.
Yeah.
They had taken up so many different ways of representing the data itself. It's a very interesting book. If you get a chance, please do Google it, have a look at it. Maybe very costly to procure, but you might be able to get some sense of it through looking at some resources that might come up, and that in itself would be interesting. Yeah.
Many thanks.
Yeah.
Thank you.
So the EVS and math pictographs also I found quite interesting in the textbooks itself, the NCERT books. I mean, they're also, but that's for smaller children. With the older kids, good to challenge them a bit more. Yeah. Any other questions or? Okay. I'm just seeing the chat comments. So this Devendra, you'd like to I'm just reading it here. If you'd like to say it, that would be, you take the data of the class of students, then they will be able to relay more. They will be able to relate to it more. By this, they will also know how graphs. Okay, so that's a suggestion, I guess. Is that, or do you want to speak tell us? Probably if you're saying if they can collect data from their own classmates, right? Trying to plot the heights and weights of their, something like that. Is that what you're saying?
I'd like to say something here. Sorry, sure. I think the gentleman, he can interrupt me anytime he comes back online.
Sure.
But I'm an early years teacher, and basically we start graph in a very simplistic way for them from nursery itself. The girl-boy ratio, who's a walker, who's a bus user. Then afterwards it moves to which is the favorite bug that you have when we are doing the insect story, topic. Nice. Then it kind of moves from two data to three to four. So it kind of, they don't know they're doing graphic representation of anything, it's fun to start off with them, and then it becomes the height. And when they see, thread, so each one is given a string and we kind of measure them out in the beginning of the year, the end of the year, they see how they've grown. So that's, I guess, is what the gentleman is saying, your height, your weight, and who's got how many teeth and how many have we've got missing. So there's a whole lot of stuff you do before, I guess, these kind of prior knowledge kind of would really benefit when it comes to your primary and the rest of the years. But it would be great if there could be any study which says about how we could start this off in early years and the primary, which would help the middle schoolers. You know, if there could be something that's done of that kind, it would be really wonderful, because I mean, all prior knowledge would have to start from back there, right? So
yes. Yeah, I think, I mean, there are some wonderful textbooks that I've seen with interesting chapters. I mean, again, I keep saying just the NCERT math book in grade 2 itself, right? Data handling, though I don't know if you're talking very young children, right? Your early years would be right from age 3, I would think, or smaller kids. Yeah, so this would be a little later. But I think that's lovely. I mean, the activities that you mentioned sounds really interesting. And I'm sure that their interest is piqued so that they can take on, right? Take on the conventions later, right? The concrete experience and interest is very much there. Yeah. So I think when it comes to a bit of, when they've engaged with reading and writing a bit more is when you can get them to, handle true. That probably.
So what you're it's doing, all very visual, of course.
Visual,
but then that
yes.
kind of moves. To...
Yes. Yeah. I think that's wonderful. I mean, at least it sounds really interesting and engaging for me. Yeah.
True. I just thought I could share a little bit of that because all of it was
thank you, grown up thing
for me. But
yes. No, it makes a lot of sense. Yeah, in terms of context. Yeah. Any other? Not sure if I've missed any question.
Okay. I think if there are no more questions, Chitra, we can move to you. Go ahead, Chitra.
Thank you, ma'am.
So do I leave, Ruchi, or?
No, just hold on. Chitra is going to thank you. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you, Sindhu, ma'am. This last hour has been an enlightening journey for all of us. And we were able to get an insight into how graphical literacy work with different grades, and your research has provided an in-depth understanding of the same. In the end, I would like to reiterate our deepest gratitude from the Center of Excellence in Teacher Education and TIS Mumbai to you and to grace us with your presence this afternoon. I would also like to thank the faculty member and also all the attendees. Thank you all for joining and have a nice day. Thanks again.
Thank you. Thanks a lot for inviting me, and thanks for to all of you for your active participation that made the session very interesting, and also all your examples as well as your interpretation. Yeah. Thank you. So I could leave now, Ruchi, if you've got something else planned. Yeah. All right. Thank you, and see you, everyone. Yeah.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you.
So, yes, we will just hold on for a few minutes for anyone who wants to fill up the feedback form and get if there are having any issues. Rest who have filled the feedback form can leave.
Yes, kindly fill the feedback form. I'll be here. If you have any problem, you can ask. The next session will be next Saturday, 3 to 4 p.m. You have joined the Telegram, you'll get the update there. Okay, sir. Thank you for joining.
Can I end the call now?